it's the steps then that they're doing for you right now.
No, they're not.
Colby, oh my god, you look so good like Maria. Like, I was like, man, you have better hair than I do.
We welcome you all here today for this memorial service to honor your friend and family member, John Samuel Jr. Norman. And I know it's been a very difficult time for the family in the last few months, and our prayers have been with you, and we want to just continue to be there for you in any way that we can to help you, Mary and John and others that are going through this difficult time. John Samuel Norman passed away on January the 18th this year at the age of 58, leaving to mourn family and friends. And we're so grateful for everybody that's come out to honor this family and just to be a comfort to them. He was predeceased by his siblings, Karen Cook and Kevin Norman. He is survived by his parents, John Sr. Norman and Mary Norman Tucker of St. George, New Brunswick, his nieces, Christy Cook of St. Stephen, New Brunswick, and Jen Brown Todd of St. John, his great-nephews Tanner, Arlo, and Christopher, and his great-niece, Rachel. He is also survived by many aunts, uncles, cousins, and countless friends, as we can tell by that crowd today. In his memory, donations to the Charlotte County Cancer Society would be appreciated by the family. Shall we pray? Father God, you are the giver of all good gifts. And we thank you for the life of Johnny Norman and for the wonderful family that is gathered here to celebrate his life. We ask that your comfort and strength will touch each one here today, and that in our mourning, we will also have cause to give thanks for all of the good that has come to us through his life. Give special strength to those who are taking part in speaking today. In Jesus' name, amen. Pastor Randy Crozier is going to come at this time, and he pastors in Seaview Full Gospel Church. He's going to read some scripture.
Let me say first that on behalf of myself and Paula, my wife, and the Seaview Full Gospel Church, we want to let you know how much we're thinking of you and praying for you. When we find ourselves in really difficult times, we inevitably start looking within ourselves, around ourselves, for strength and help. And we're often blessed by friends and neighbors, family members who can be an encouragement to us. But we know from the Word that the Word is a strength in itself. And let me read some verses to you. And these are from various places in the Psalms and elsewhere. I sought the Lord and he answered me. He delivered me from all my fears. Those who look to him are radiant. Their faces are never covered with shame. This poor man called and the Lord heard him. He saved him out of all of his troubles. The angel of the Lord encamps around those who fear him and he delivers them. The righteous cry out and the Lord hears them. He delivers them from all their troubles. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of compassion and the God of all comfort, who comforts us in all of our troubles so that we can comfort those in any trouble with the comfort we ourselves receive from God. For just as we share abundantly in the sufferings of Christ, so also our comfort abounds through Christ. He heals the brokenhearted and binds up their wounds. The Lord is close to the brokenhearted and saves those who are crushed in spirit. I encourage you to look to him for the strength that only he can give.
I got one.
Thank you, Pastor Crozier. The eulogy is going to be read by Charlie Norman, who is an uncle to Johnny.
It's okay, right there, thanks. Well, there, quite an entrance. I rehearsed that for a few days. I don't do stairs real well. But anyway, we're gathered here this afternoon to pay our respects to the life of John Samuel Norman Jr., son of John and Mary, brother to Karen Cook and Kevin Norman, both deceased. John, as he's known to his parents, was known to his many aunts and uncles throughout his entire life as Little Johnny or Young Johnny.
even though his terms as a year older still stayed with him. And an oddity that I noticed over the years that I can't say that I ever remember him calling Johnny or Mary mom and dad. He always referred to them as mother and father. If you talk to him, he'd say, well, father. And that two of Johnny's young loves were his nieces, Christy and Jennifer. Even though at times he had difficulty expressing that love, if you talk to him one-on-one, it was very obvious how he felt about them. Little Johnny was one kid who had plenty of smarts, actually quite intelligent, who did not like school, leaving in grade 8. This no doubt limits one's ability to find or obtain meaningful work. But Johnny worked hard in progressing and obtaining work, advancing along the way. He spent the last many years, and I call it the can and cover, even though that's not necessarily the technical term of the company of Black's Harbor. He proved to be a hard-working man, always willing to learn, seldom missing a day of work. And at a very young age, we all noticed that Johnny loved going fast. And it was very obvious when he got his first bicycle. That quest and desire followed him right into his teen years when he got his driver's license and driving cars. One time in particular, I remember I happened to be at Johnny and Mary's, and he borrowed his father's Jimmy truck, which had a big motor in it and pretty fast in itself. But I remember his dad saying to him, now, you take that truck, I don't want you to turn that air filter over. Because when you turn that over, it makes a noise, makes it sound more aggressive and more powerful than what it is. So we were sitting at the house, and all of a sudden you could hear him coming across the bridge. It sounded like he was doing about 120. Pulled in the yard, and Johnny went out to say, listen, I thought I told you not to turn that filter over. And he said, I didn't. And Johnny, of course, my brother John would say, you know, well, how did I don't know how it happened. He's totally flabbergasted, like poof. And couldn't help it. Even Johnny and Mary, we all had to chuckle about it because he had the truck. It wasn't that long, and he didn't expect us to be back. He wanted to get home before us, and we were in the yard, and when he came across the bridge, you could hear him. Some of Johnny's passions in life were deer hunting, meat pies, lobster, and working on engines and cars. He loved to hunt oftentimes with his friend Bill, which proved to be beneficial for Claudette, his aunt, as she always made her traditional Christmas meat pies that he sort of liked. And in the meat pies, you could put deer meat in them, if you had any. Well, if you know me, I wasn't a provider of deer meat. And for a lot of years, Johnny was the one that provided the deer meat for the pies. Each year, Claudette would make a couple of pies, take over to the family, and young Johnny, he to say that he liked them would be an understatement. And at least 2 to 3 times each year, he always managed to have a feed of lobster for his mother and father. Although not formally trained in the field of automotive, he was very knowledgeable and good at doing minor repairs to motors and small engines. As much as John never missed work, he became quite adept at avoiding putting in the winter wood when when it came time to do so, he always could disappear. However, during the last few years, he stepped up, not only in putting in the wood, but also in keeping the morning and evening fires going. One fact that, I always say I'm an emotional one, not a joke. One fact that a lot of you may not know about is that decades ago, Johnny was in a car accident and injured his back. After visiting specialists and physiotherapists several times, it was determined that corrective surgery was not an option. Thus, since that time, he has lived with constant back pain. He still maintained a full-time job and an active life. However, just a couple of years ago, he had to finally give in and went on disability insurance. As we say our goodbyes today to little Johnny, Uncle Johnny, and John, I am reminded of a line from an old Bob Dylan song. That is, I seen a shooting star tonight, and I thought of you. Later, John.
We have a gentleman step in front of him, maybe just to help him steady him, Casey.
Usually always a little bit easier going down the stairs than going up. Thank you, gentlemen, for your help. And thank you for that beautiful eulogy, very touching. And at this time, we're going to have a song. And I'm going to invite my wife, Elaine, and Bobby Joe to come and help us sing. You probably know this song. We're going to have the words up today. All right. And put it in a key, make it comfortable for everybody to sing. May you find comfort in the words.
You made me dance.
Privileged to have a lovely visit with Mary and John Sr. A week ago Wednesday, and was asking for just some of the details of Johnny's life so I could try to personalize this message, and I promise you I won't be very long today. But I was told that, as was already mentioned today, that Johnny loved to hunt fish and loved tinkering on old cars, and that Johnny was the type of man who loved helping other people out. Those of you that know him well would know that about him. He was a very quiet man, but always there to lend a hand. And if somebody ran out of gas or had a breakdown, he would be there picking up a gas can from his dad and say, I need to go help somebody out. And I like stories like that. I think they're wonderful, and I'm sure that you're very proud of this. As was mentioned, he worked for Connors Brothers for 37 years. And stayed in the boat shop right out of school, and then worked in the cannon cover division of Black's Harbor. So a busy man, and I'm sure that she's very sadly missed today. We'd like to read from Revelation chapter 3 and verse 20, where Jesus is speaking, and he said, Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man hear my voice and open the door, I will come into him and will sup with him and he with me. Well, we all know what it's like to get that surprise at the door when somebody shows up, but we haven't seen them for a long time, and they're there and unexpectedly, and perhaps mothers or housewives, you didn't have a chance to clean up and tidy up, and first thing goes through your mind is, oh my goodness, the living room is a mess. But, you know, they're really there to see you and not your living room. And you're so glad to see them that it's not long and you get into conversation and you're just so happy that they showed up. Now, for some people, that kind of thing, that just really throws them off if you show up. And I know that as a pastor that there are some folks that you always call ahead. And I have a pastor friend one time, he called and he said, I'm coming by to see you. And it was my first cousin once removed that he was going to go visit, and she and her husband, and she said, oh, no, you're not. Oh, she said, I haven't had a chance to tidy up the house. And he said, oh, that's fine. Oh, no, she said, it isn't. Well, I'll only stay 10 minutes. Oh, no, you won't. So, you know, you can get different kind of reactions, and I'm sure that if you've ever been involved in doing any door-to-door sales, you've found that some people are just so easy, and some people are so difficult to get past that. But if you can get in that door, you stand a chance with your product. Well, I think the Lord Jesus Christ understands what it's like to stand at a door and to receive different kinds of receptions. Interesting, but this passage of scripture was not written to the world in general. It was written to the church. And of the seven churches that were addressed in Revelation, this one particular one stands apart from all the others because Jesus was not in that church. He was standing outside the church, and he was knocking on the door to get in. Mm-hmm. Can you imagine that? Standing outside your own church and wanting to get in. Well, you would think Jesus would automatically be there. His spirit, his presence would be there. But in the case of the Laodicean church, Jesus was on the outside looking in. They were on the inside looking out. And unfortunately, when he was standing knocking at the door, many were not recognizing him. And today, Jesus is still standing at the door and he's knocking. But this time it's at your heart's door and my heart's door. And he said, "Behold, I stand." He's waiting. He said, "I knock." He's politely waiting. He doesn't barge in where he's not welcome. And he said, "If any man will hear my voice and open the door, I will come in." Now, you would think that everybody would want Jesus to be a part of their lives. But if Jesus had difficulty getting into one of the churches in Asia Minor, how many know that sometimes he has difficulty getting into our lives as well? I have found that for many people that I know that have turned their lives over to Jesus, that the thing that actually became the door for him to be able to enter into their life was the difficulties of life, the problems. Why is it that when we are facing life's hardest moments that we are most vulnerable to the Lord's touch and to him being introduced in our lives? I guess when we come to that point, and we all will, and we all do from time to time have difficult times, and I don't doubt that there's even one person here that is not carrying around some kind of baggage, some kind of hurt, some kind of worry or fear, some kind of struggle that you wish would go away or could be resolved. As I would say that if we were to do a poll today, we're all honest that every single one of us is hurting over something in our lives. Can you say amen? I think that's really true. And the beautiful picture that is painted in Revelation 3 and 20 is of a kind and merciful Jesus standing at the door saying, "If you'll just open up that door, I'd like to come in. I'd like to help you. I'd like to encourage you. I'd like to be a friend like no other friend." But because he's so polite and because he does not push his way in, he stands and he knocks. Unfortunately, some people will never answer the door and never allow him in. We'll never know the peace and the joy that comes by having an intimate relationship with God. But today, the opportunity is here for each one of us to know God in a very personal, a very real way, because he says, "If any man will open the door, I will come in." In other words, the Lord doesn't make any exceptions. It doesn't matter how up and out we are, how down and out we are, what our background is. The Lord wants to acquaint himself with us, and he wants to be a part of our lives, not just in the bad times, but in the good times. You know, if you share a joy with a friend, it's twice the joy. You share a sorrow with a friend, it becomes half the sorrow. And the Lord is a friend like none other, because he can move into our heart and life, and he can take away pain that nobody can see and nobody can touch and nobody can help. He can answer questions that nobody else can answer. And he can give the wisest counsel and the greatest encouragement. I wonder sometimes as a pastor why we don't all swing wide open the door and just say, "Come in, Lord, and do what you need to do with me." And now it's interesting here, he didn't say, "I'll come in and I'll take over your life." That'd be good if he would, because I think the world would be a lot better place. But instead, he says, "I'll come in and I'll take part in your daily life. I'd like to have lunch with you." You say, "Well, that sounds kind of strange for the Savior to talk like that." But what he was trying to tell us, he says, "I'll come down on your level. I want to be a part of your life in the everyday details. I want to be with you in the little things and the big things. I just want to be part of your life in every area." He said, "I want to dine with you." You know, dining together is something that usually only friends do. And what Jesus is saying is, "I want to be a friend to you. I want to share in your life, and I want you to share in mine." He says, "I will come in." He keeps his promises. Today, I know that we've probably all prayed and we've asked that God would help John and Mary, and who are particularly suffering and feeling grief. You know, it's everybody's aware of their story and what they've gone through. And I said to Mary and John when I was talking to them on Wednesday, I said, "You're very, very strong people." And I know they probably don't feel that way today. But I see a tremendous strength and a selflessness. And just how they have handled this is so amazing. And I know that God has got to be helping you. He's got to be your strength, or you wouldn't be able to keep this up. But let me tell you this, that you don't have to be strong all the time. It's all right to shed a tear. It's all right to have a breakdown. In fact, I think it's very good to do that. I believe that tears are a language that God understands. And when you can't articulate the words, and when you can't express what you feel and what you need from God today, God hears the groanings of our heart, and God can interpret those as prayers. Don't think for a moment that that sigh or that wave of sadness is not a prayer. It certainly is a prayer. It's a prayer that Jesus understands, because he's down here on our level, and he wants to meet us right where we are today. And if Jesus were here in the flesh today, I'll tell you what he would do for each one of you. He would come up close to where you are, and with eyes so kind and tender and the sweetest smile on his face, he would throw those arms around about you, and he would pull you into his chest, and he would say, there, my child, it's going to be all right. And you would feel his strength, you would feel his comfort, because he is the wonderful counselor. He's a friend that sticks closer than a brother. He's the Almighty God. He's the everlasting Father. He is the Prince of Peace today. And I hope that in this service today, you feel the peace that passes understanding. I hope that you feel this Jesus knocking on your heart's door. And I hope you throw that door open so wide that it comes right off the hinges and say, Lord Jesus, just come into my heart and into my life today. I need you. I think the songwriter put it so well when he or she said, Jesus, take the wheel. Jesus, take the wheel. And you know, there's a ditch on the left side, and there's a ditch on the right side. And I don't think that the enemy of our soul cares which ditch we go into. There's a ditch that for people who are trying so hard to do the right thing. And then there's a ditch on the other side where people just say anything goes. Either one is a disaster. Either one is an accident. But you know something? If you let Jesus take the wheel of your life, I guarantee you, he will keep you out of the ditch. He will keep you on the straight and narrow. And he'll take you to a beautiful home that he has prepared. In fact, he's been preparing it for 2,000 years. He said, behold, I prepare for you a home. And if where I am, I will come back and I will receive you unto myself. If it were not so, I would have told you. He keeps his promises. Amen. We're going to sing another song and have another prayer. And going to ask the trio to come back at this time. And this song is one of my absolute favorites. I've sung it at many memorial services, and it's called Sheltered in the Arms of God.
Rise, they won't worry.
So let's just pray today. Jesus, we come before your throne today. And God, I ask that you'll grant special mercy and special favor upon this family. God, I pray, Lord, that you'll extend grace and mercy and that you'll give strength, especially to John and Mary at this time. I pray that the comfort from your spirit will be in this family. God, I pray that you'll help us to be brave in our remembering today and honest in our sorrow and open in our love. And I pray that you'll help us to be compassionate to each other today. God, I pray that you'll let your peace that only you can provide surround everyone in this moment. And I pray that you'll give us your peace more abundantly, your love, your joy, your comfort, and your light. And I pray that you will be this family's strength, God, in this hard time as they walk through the valley. God, I pray that you will strengthen them and comfort them, walk with them every step of the way, and continue to lead and guide them. And let us all know that we are safe in your arms. And we ask this in your name, Jesus. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you, Brother James. The burial will be service will be conducted at St. George Rural Cemetery. And then immediately following, there will be a reception here at Cornerstone Tabernacle. We invite you to come back for tea and coffee and some sandwiches and sweets. So God bless you.
Please rise.
Sorry.
mine.
This one's yours?
Yeah. Okay, those two.
You're welcome.